Good morning. My name's Stephen Phillips from Hewlett-Packard. It's my pleasure this morning to introduce our next speaker. We have Paul Flewelling from Fairfax Media, and he is going to be talking to us about News Rewired, creating the digital newsroom. Paul's an agile coach. He's based in Wellington, New Zealand, and he's been involved professionally in software development for 23 years. And he began delivering software after working on a very complex project for a government organisation, which delivered and met all of the requirements, ticked all of the QA boxes, but still failed to deliver what the customer actually needed. Two startups, an agile software development shop, and an agile consultancy later, he joined Fairfax Media in search of a bigger challenge, and he believes he's found it. So please welcome to the stage, Paul. Thank you.
Cool. Thanks, Stephen. Hey, today I'm going to start by taking a selfie, guys, because we're running a competition down on our stand. You can win a free magazine subscription for the best selfie of the conference. So smile, everybody. Nice. Hang on, one more. Thank you. Just come and see us. If you tweet at StuffCogs with your selfie, we'll let you know who wins the subscription. As Stephen was saying, I got into agile coaching about 5-6 years ago, but I actually started my agile journey a long time ago after being on so many software projects, one in particular that just failed to deliver. We like you said, we ticked all of the boxes. We met all of the requirements. It tested out well. We delivered it to our customer, and it wasn't what they wanted. And it took us another 6 months to rework that into something that our customer actually wanted. That's a different story. That's what started me on my journey, thinking there must be a better way to deliver software than this. This is today is a story about Fairfax Media. This transformation's been going on for a couple of years now. So what's this session about? It's a digital transformation. It's taking place at Fairfax. What is a digital transformation, you might be asking yourself? Some of you might be in digital transformations already, but this is just for the people who aren't. It's sort of the third sort of stage in adopting digital. So you start off with competence, you move to literacy, and then transformation is the third and final stage. And transformation is when you master the art of digital, and you're really moving into, you're moving past the point where you're just mimicking your existing process in a digital form, and you're starting to adapt and be creative and actually innovate digital into something that's going to change the way that you work forever. This is from Wikipedia, by the way. And the second line in this really grabbed me because it's got a double meaning for us as a newspaper company. In a narrow sense, digital transformation may refer to the concept of going paperless. And for us, that is really why we're here today, because we're a newspaper company, but newspapers are in decline. Very few people buy print these days. We're having to shift the way that we deliver the news to our audience needs and wants. I'll get to that later. I'm going to ask you guys a few questions as we go. So Fairfax's digital transformation is why we're here. It's a story. I'm not a journalist, so don't get me wrong, but I do like telling stories, so I'll try and tell this one the best that I can. It's in two parts. The first part is a look at where we've come from in the last 2 years. It's been an interesting 2 years, to say the least, and I'll try and cover that off as much as I can within the time that we've got. The key thing is I want to talk about the road ahead as well. But there's a focus here for us, and the focus is on the learnings that we've got from this transformation. That's the real part that I want to convey to you guys, is what we've learned from this transformation and the way that we've done it. So my role in this transformation. This is a few members of the team. There's a few of them sitting down here at the front here. This is a few members of one of our delivery teams. We're quite a small group. Let me start again. So I'm an agile coach working for a product technology for Fairfax Media. Product technology are the people who deliver the platforms that the journalists, the editors work on. We essentially deliver something you might have heard of, which is stuff.co.nz as well. So we're providing the platform that the journalists enter their articles, their stories into. That one of the endpoints for that, those articles is Stuff. Another endpoint for those articles are the newspapers that we produce, which are, you know, amongst other things, the Don Post, the Sunday Star Times, and so on. This is back to the kitchen. This was us experimenting with Agile and trying to understand a little bit about Agile in terms of metaphors. We're actually, I asked the team what they what would be a good metaphor for Agile kind of thinking, and they said, it's like making a cake. It's just like making a cake, and like you're adjusting your recipe as you go. You're constantly looking at what you're doing in terms of retrospectives, or you know, adapting and changing, and you're changing and mastering the art of making a good recipe. And so we made microwave mug cakes. So you put all your ingredients into a cake, into a mug, and stick it in the microwave for a couple of minutes. We thought that was the simplest way. You know, you're trying to do the simplest thing you can in an agile way, and that was the simplest cake that we could think of that we could make. And we'll keep changing our recipe as we go, hopefully. So a little history. This is so Fairfax is we're a big company. We're trans-Tasman, so we're Australian owned, but we are a separate entity in New Zealand for all intents and purposes. I'll just give you the local history though, to give you a bit of a feel for where we came from and why we're on this journey. So in Wellington, it started with the Blundell brothers, Irish family, three brothers, set up a printing press. They started printing a newspaper called the Evening Post in 1865. In 1907, kind of as an answer to the Evening Post, a group of like-minded businessmen set up a fairly conservative paper called the Dominion Post. So the Blundell brothers, the Dominion, the Evening Post is a fairly liberal paper. The Dominion was a fairly conservative paper, business-oriented. Between 1907 and 1972, Rupert Murdoch bought a stake in the Dominion in 1964. He bought a 30% chunk of the Dominion. He then expanded his kind of ownership of that. It was his first overseas purchase. That was his first foray into the international kind of market. He then expanded it to 50%. They bought a whole bunch of papers in the process. One of those was the Waikato Times, which was owned by Independent News. Independent News was the brand that they decided to adopt and they took forward. So the Dominion and the Evening Post consolidated under that one company title in 1972. INL, as they're now, or they were then known, took stuff.co.live in 2000. Independent News then merges the Dominion and the Evening Post to get what we've got today, which is the Dominion Post. One morning newspaper. Fairfax, they were a family-owned company from Australia, then acquired all of INL's publications from Murdoch. So there's about 80 publications back in 2003. So that's when Rupert Murdoch, his ownership ends with INL. We took our first mobile offering. I don't know if anyone remembers mobile in those days, 2003. It was a WAP or WAP interface. It was fairly basic. I certainly used it for getting ski reports and stuff like that. Stuff goes live in our first mobile offering goes live in 2009. iOS apps, Android apps. And finally, we get to our transformation in 2013. This is when we started it. Now, what triggered this transformation was a new CEO coming into the company saying, so what's this digital thing and why aren't we doing it? And that went back to a conversation that happened in a boardroom in 2005 when the then board said, digital's not going to impact us. We're not going to need to do digital. It's just going to be seen as a little side thing. We'll do some of it, but we're not going to do all of it. We're always going to be newspaper people and magazine people. Fortunately, our CEO in 2013, our new CEO came in and said, no, actually, this digital thing, he was from a digital company, he said, this is going to be a lot bigger than you guys think it is, and we're going to have to change the way that we work. And just looking at the world around us, looking at what was happening, New Zealand, they make a joke about New Zealand being several years behind the rest of the world, but it works to our benefit sometimes, and in this instance it does. We could see newspaper in decline all around the world. It wasn't affecting us at that stage. We had pretty steady numbers, but based on what was happening in the rest of the world, we started our transformation. So for us in New Zealand, that's newspapers, magazines, iOS apps, stuff.co.nz, Android and mobile stuff. Just to give you a taste of what our newspaper portfolio looks like, these are all of our newspapers within New Zealand. There's community papers, regional papers, and then our mastheads, which are the things like the Dominion Post, the Sunday Star Times, and so on. We've got about 700 journalists, editors in New Zealand working on these, and then we've got hundreds of sales staff supporting that behind the scenes as well. And then expanding that out, we've got the Australian part of the business as well, which they've got multiple, you know, threads of our DNA coming into this as well. So there's papers like the Sydney Morning Herald, The Age, there's Brisbane Times and so on. They've all come from a similar lineage to us. So they've got the similar sort of kind of, there are businesses that stood on their own two feet, basically. They were isolated, siloed businesses that came to form into one conglomerate called Fairfax. So I've got some activity for you guys now. I've got a bunch of things that I want to ask you. There's going to be two types of question in this activity. There's stand-up questions and there's hands-up questions. I'm going to start with a stand-up question, please. Could you all stand up, please? Can you remain standing if you've read print or news in print form in the last month? Cool. Can you remain standing if you've read the news in print form in the last week? Can you remain standing if you've read the news in the last day in print form? It's good to see there's three people standing, so, you know. Yeah, that's right. So that was my next question. For all of those that read print, and have a good look around at this, please have a good look around at the rest of the crowd. What's hands up question? Who's read? Who's bought a magazine or newspaper in the last month? Cool. Are they? Who's got a regular subscription to a magazine or news? Cool. Great. So there's a few people who still hold print quite dearly. I'm going to ask you to all stand up again, please. Now, same questions, but for digital. Who's read the news in digital form in the last month? Remain standing. Remain standing if you've read digital form news in the last week, in the last day. So have a good look around, please. There was three people standing up at the end of the last session, the last question. Now pretty much there's a few people down over there that have sat down. Cool. Sit down, please. Now, for those people that read in digital form, who's purchased or subscribed to a digital magazine or newspaper? So there's a few people. Cool. So this is, I did have one other question, which was from people who have read like the news in the last day or so, is anyone reading the news right now? Have you got it on your phone? Just checking. So just trying to show you what, you know, this feels like for us in New Zealand. We're having our sort of business model as a newspaper company disrupted. We're having to transition into something much more digital to meet our changing audience. I'll talk you through this in a bit more detail. So we're transforming to digital centric. We started with print. Over time, print, we've combined resources on print, so we shared print printing presses, we've shared distribution. Then this thing called digital comes along, and it's seen as the outsider. It's really seen, you know, it's initially seen as the new kid on the block, but then it's seen as a huge disruptor as well. And so print don't know what to do with it, and they, in some parts of our business, they were actually trying to shun digital and hiding content from digital, seeing it as a the reason that newspapers were in decline. But over time, digital's eked its way into our ecosystem. It's touching all of our, or pretty much touching all aspects of our business. And this is where we're at today. And then in the next couple of years, this is where we want to be, where we have a digital-first approach to content. And the way that what we would like is digital to be the primary platform, and then we can disseminate or syndicate our content out to our audience wherever they want it, whether that's in print form or digital form. So that's what we're doing. Why are we doing it? This is the printing press in Petone, or part of the printing press in Petone at least. When we extended the Petone plant 2 years ago, it cost us $20 million. It's not cheap to own a printing press. Our distribution costs run into tens of millions of dollars every year as well. It's not cheap to distribute hard copy news either. You need to be in the game if you're going to play this game. And so for a long time, this was our competitive, or this protected our business model. It was, if you like, part of our competitive advantage that we had the money to own this equipment, and other people couldn't easily get into the newspaper game unless they had this kind of money. Then this came along. The internet changed everything. This hugely disrupts our business model. Anybody can now publish news. You just need a WordPress installation and a server that you can, you know, disseminate your content to the world on. It's not quite that simple, I know. You need to have, I mean, journalists are, there is a craft to journalism. I know people don't often respect that, but the journalists do have a code, a code of ethics and so on that they have to abide by, and they are legally bound to be truthful and factual in their content. But anybody can disrupt our model now. For example, the Huffington Post. Yeah, I don't know if you've, has anyone read the Huffington Post or read the Huffington Post? A few people. It's the first digital newspaper. It has no hard copies. You can't buy this in print form. As a result of where we came from as well, in terms of like the different newspapers coming together and different streams, what I referred to as our DNA, our strands of our DNA coming together into one business, we had these self-standing newspaper groups that were able to, they very much were in silos and they didn't talk to each other easily. They very much protected their own territory. And so as a result, we had a lot of siloed thinking within our business, where people were not thinking about the best for Fairfax as a whole, but they were thinking about the best for their particular niche or their particular masthead newspaper. So sales, advertising, and so on was all very focused on one particular paper. Part of the reason why we're doing this as well is this is the digital audience in New Zealand. So this is figures from Nielsen for New Zealand as a whole, not just for us, for Fairfax. So we have a roughly 3.6 million unique audience who are internet connected in New Zealand. And for those 3.6 million people, we have 42 million unique browsers. I know unique browsers isn't a real way to measure things, but it's indicative of a trend, and that trend is desktop digital hasn't changed. It's changed about 1% in the last year, but mobile has grown 106% in the last year. We're moving to mobile as an audience. And moving to mobile, it doesn't, you know, means we have multiple mediums. I personally read the news, desktop and mobile, and occasionally in newspaper form as well. But mostly mobile, and I'm on the go. There's some vanity metrics for you. I'm calling them vanity metrics because it doesn't mean much. This isn't how we measure our success. How you measure your success is how successful you are or how sustainable you are as an organization. But in May 2014, we had 1.47 million unique browsers for the month. This May 2015, we've grown by 25.7% to 1.85 million browsers. Stuff is growing. People that are coming to stuff is growing. Our audience is shifting. Just to continue the vanity metrics and the reason why we're doing this, Stuff has become the largest domestic website based on unique browsers in New Zealand. We just overtook TradeMe this year. I mean, TradeMe will definitely beat us every time on page views. People that go on TradeMe are fairly committed to what they do, and they do a lot on TradeMe. I've spent a long time on TradeMe. But in terms of unique browsers, Stuff is edged in front. So we've got a big audience, is all I'm trying to say, a big audience within New Zealand. And we're only playing second fiddle to the Google, Facebook, and or Microsoft conglomerates. The final piece of information is 50% of our audience is mobile. That's purely based on our statistics, our analytics. Over 50% of our audience is mobile. So that's the reason why we're doing this. Now I'd like to show you what we're actually doing. This part of this is already underway or complete, and some of this is still in progress. And I'll try and talk you through that now. So the top stream here is our digital transformation in terms of the technology for our digital platforms, which would be Stuff and other online web news portals that we have. And so we aimed to combine our CMSs, our content management systems, together into one platform. So we brought together basically all of the Australian web platforms and our own stuff.co.nz into one digital platform. And the intention of that was that we could easily syndicate our news across our network. So anybody, say in Sydney, if they wanted to publish an article from Wellington or Auckland, they could easily grab that content from our content management system and publish it on the smh.com.au's website. So in that process of unifying our content management systems, obviously we wanted to upgrade our authoring tools and our publishing tools. The newsroom, allegedly they're on a much better platform than they were. Our predecessor CMS was a bit hard to use. They've got modern authoring tools, but they've also got a flexible way of publishing as well. And we're still working on aspects of creating that flexible publishing tool for them. And the final stage of that is we very simply connected our digital and our print content together. So people go into the one CMS, regardless of their the target of their article, their content, they type in their story, their article, and then that can be pushed either to digital or it can be pushed through our print process to paper or magazine. So let's talk about that stream now. This is the second stream that you can see here, which is our print process. I just want to talk about the print process as it is or as it was, and why how we're restructuring this. We currently, a journalist will go into the content management system, enter their story. That's the might be the last they see of that story. They just give the basic kind of outline of the story. It then gets passed through a series of sub-editors who then will do a number of things. They'll add a title to that story that fits within. In print terms, we talk about a news hole, and the news hole could be the front page of the Don Post. It could be the second page of the Waikato Times. It could be a magazine. It could be anywhere. There could be multiple news holes for a story. But what the sub-editors do is they come through and they make sure that the title fits, the content fits to that, you know, the 400 words, for example, that's all fitting. If it doesn't fit, they'll edit the content. They then will, somebody else will come through and check that story or article fits well on in terms of page layout, and they will make sure that that content doesn't conflict with anything else on the page, i.e., there's not two stories clashing on the page. Finally, advertising or commercial sub-editors will come through and make sure that we're not clashing in terms of we're not running a an Air New Zealand advert next to a story about a plane crash. It's not, you know, not very popular for your advertising or commercial if you're showing those two things together. So that's the way that the current process works. What we're trying to do is simplify that so that we can, you know, you're probably all familiar with blogging or some form of social media where you're editing something and you'll go into your say you're writing a new blog post, you'll create that blog post. If you're lucky, someone else will edit it for you or review it for you. 9 times out of 10, you'll just push publish. And because you know digital is forgivable, if you like, or you can be forgiven in digital. You can go back and change things. You can republish easily and so on. With print, we don't have that kind of, you know, you get it right or you get it wrong. And once the presses start rolling, it's very expensive to stop those presses rolling. So what we've done is we want a more digital approach to the way that we do things. We want to be able to write the content and publish. And we want the journalist to be able to own that content from start to finish, from creation through to publication. So we're restructuring the newsroom. We're retraining our editorial and journalists so that they can become what we call publish ready, and they will own their content from start to finish. And part of that is a quality first program. I know we're famous. We get so much, for want of a better word, crap about the number of. You'd be amazed by the number of emails we get. I found 3 spelling mistakes on one article. This grammar isn't right, and so on. There's a lot of people who help us out with our spelling and grammar. But part of this is that we are shifting that so that we can. What happened was digital came along. We had to get things out fast. We had to compete with the likes of Facebook and Twitter and so on in terms of delivering the news. As a result of that, our process suffered a little bit, and journalists who were not necessarily used to publishing so quickly got caught in the fact that they were pushing stories out before they were properly edited and so on. So quality first is all about improving our standards within the newsroom. Simplifying the print production process is about shortening that or removing the sub-editing steps so that one journalist is able to manage all of that content as it goes through to whatever point it's being published. I'll talk a little bit more about the layout software that we use for print maybe later, but it's a very complicated beast, to say the least. It's not easy. There's a specialist kind of layout language or markup language that you need to use for print. And not a lot of journalists know it. That's why we have some of these sub-editing steps, because they're skilled people who have learnt a kind of fairly niche language. It's not like ordinary markup languages even. Finally, the last step, which is still underway, is aligning content through templating. We're community papers especially, we're heavily templating those so that we can use templates across all of those papers that we publish throughout New Zealand. And we can even share content easily across those different pages. So we might even copy one page if it's appropriate to a regional paper. For example, the Wellingtonian here, we might copy a page out to Porirua's local community papers if it's appropriate. So we use templates. We'll use templates heavily in the future to achieve that. So that's the guts of our transformation. We're pretty much complete on this. We've got things to do still, and we're heavily focused on this part at the moment and restructuring our newsroom. So let's get to the juice. This is why we're really here. This is the learnings section. I'll talk you through. There's some stories behind these. I'll try and make the story is clear, but please stick your hand up if you want to question anything that I'm saying. So learning number one, change management. This is Bruce Jenner and Caitlyn Jenner. I had to put this up because we get so much stick about the Kardashians. You know, everyone says, get the Kardashians off your website. What are you guys, all you are Kardashian this, Kardashian that. But we'll stop publishing it when you stop clicking on it, is basically the message I've got for you guys. Bruce Jenner to Caitlyn Jenner. Caitlyn Jenner had a vision. She had a vision. She stuck by that vision. She made it very clear what she was trying to achieve. And she had, fortunately for her, she had money and multiple channels which to do that through in terms of like the media. And even though she was given a lot of stick for this, you know, what was she doing? Why did she want to be, you know, go through this huge transformation? She stuck to her vision and she carried it out. And I think, well, you know, this is just my opinion. I think it was highly successful from her perspective. Now, we have the same kind of issues. A lot of people misconstrue what we're trying to achieve. This is the New Zealand Herald, of course. We don't own the New Zealand Herald, by the way. A lot of people think we do, but we don't. Of course, they're going to take any story about us and our transformation and try and spin those figures or facts for their own good. To be fair, they did a fairly good article on us here. This is 160 staff. What we're doing is disestablishing a bunch of roles within our editorial so that we can restructure our editorial group to be the quality first, publish-ready group of journalists that we want. Now, they were talking about us shedding staff and so on, but we actually, talking to the group chief editor about this, she was saying we're actually hiring more staff than we're disestablishing. So the roles we're disestablishing, we're creating more roles than the ones that we're disestablishing. We're just going through a radical restructure, and some journalists aren't going to be comfortable with that. They aren't going to like that editorial process that's very digital and very now. So we have that. We get the, you know, we have a vision, but we obviously will have our vision misconstrued or used against us appropriately. But the way that we stuck to it was by branding up our change. We created this brand called News Rewired. This goes on our, this, we've got an intranet. All of our reasons for what we're doing and why we're doing it are communicated throughout the company. All of our newsletters and information about the change that's sent out to our staff is communicated using this logo. Basically, the editorial group that are managing this transformation have a vision, and they clearly state that vision. And it's very hard to argue with them. They know clearly where they want to go. You might not like it, but this is the journey that we're on. The thing with this is that the learning that we've got, or the deepest learning that I got from this, was vision and mission are very different things, and then they're not the same thing. A vision is something that somebody holds for you as a leader. They hold that vision, and as the people that are trying to fulfill that or meet that vision, you adapt your mission as you go, and you change your mission. You can't always, you know, you're going to learn things as you go. This is a period of innovation for us. We don't know all of the answers. We've got ideas about where we're going, but we don't have all of the answers. So we, you know, hold that vision is the key learning for us. Hold the vision, and then people can adapt their mission to meet that vision. Learning number two, this is a wall that I did with we completed the 2 years of our migration, and we ran a project retrospective to try and cover off what we'd learned in those 2 years. This is just a small section of those post-it notes. This wall is quite long. I couldn't fit it all into a photo. We did a lot of things right in those 2 years. The migration, we had our existing content management system. We bought up a new content management system alongside it. We started to gradually move different parts of our content management system from old to new. And when they were ready, we published from the new. So we had, for a long time, we had a hybrid website, which was, for example, publishing sections from, like technology was our first section, for example, that we published from the new content management system. The rest of the stuff website was publishing from the old content management system, but if you went to technology, you got the new shiny content management system. So we did a lot of things right in that migration. Some of the things we didn't do right was we weren't realistic about our timelines. We thought we could publish that first section from our new content management system within 6 months. It took us over a year. And the learning from that, I mean, someone was saying yesterday, failure is not a bad thing. You need Failure is something that's telling you something, it's teaching you something. If you've got to learn from that failure. We eventually did learn from that failure, and that was that we weren't going to get our content migrated as quite as quickly as we thought we were. And in the meantime, while we were changing everything behind the scenes and we were creating these beautiful new authoring tools for our editors and so on, and the way that we published was changing as well, we hadn't changed anything for our audience. Our audience hadn't seen a change at all. And so that kind of leads me into the next point, which is don't like for like unless your timelines are realistic. This is stuff as it looked before we started our migration. And this is how stuff would have looked after we finished our migration if we hadn't have realized what we were doing wrong. Fortunately, we saw it. We saw it fairly late in the play, and we made adjustments, and we came through with this redesign in late in the migration piece. But this is just a veneer, if you like, on stuff. This is only starting to tap into what we're capable of as a team, and we're now behind the scenes. Currently, we're going on a massive journey trying to for want of a better word, mobile first or adaptive in terms of our templating. This we do have a mobile version of this, but it's very old. I don't know how old. How old do you reckon it is, guys? That current mobile, 2008, 2009. We're addressing that as quickly as we can to create a modern web experience for our audience. But that's a learning from us, was that we changed everything behind the scenes because we weren't realistic about our timelines. We thought we could migrate quickly and then do this work. We should have done this work as we were going, in retrospect. This is a crucial business system, if you like, for us. This is our business. This is pivotal to our success. And if our audience isn't engaged with what we're doing, then we've stuffed up. This is our release train. As I said before, we've got 30 people in product technology here in New Zealand, but we've got roughly 150 in Australia. And the key message for this is that our release train, there's a lot of people on it, okay? A lot of people on our release train. We were trying to release as a group, we were trying to release as a whole. And what this led to was massive, massive releases happening roughly once a month. We would roughly, those month cycles were roughly made up of 2 weeks of software development and then 2 weeks of scrabbling like crazy to regression test everything else that was coming in from all of the other teams. Suddenly, all of the other teams were chucking code into our release, and we are a small agile team, two small agile teams plus some software support plus online hosting or DevOps, against 8 or 9 teams in Australia of about 150 people all chucking code into this one huge release. And we were struggling because we've got fairly high standards, or we like to think we have. We do test-driven approaches. We automate our tests as much as possible. Other teams don't quite have those standards. And as a result of that, we were getting a lot of code that was broken or not working. But as you can see, the release train has a mass. And once it starts rolling, it doesn't stop very easily. So you might spot as you're going that things are broken or other teams are releasing stuff that doesn't work well for you. But if the Australian Financial Review needs the upgrade to its website next week, for example, then a very real example for us, then that train's going to keep moving and you're going to release rubbish into your production environment just because the train has kept moving. What we've learned from this is breaking out of the release train. Get off the train as soon as you can. Find ways that you can independently release against the other teams without breaking what they're doing. We started that early this year. We went for our first independent releases on the publication side, because Stuff is a very separate website from other websites in our mix. But we also then had to break ourselves away from the authoring side as well, because we were sharing authoring tools with Australia. We then did that finally a few months ago, we broke away by separating our production environments from Australia. So we operate on two different clusters now, the Australian cluster and the New Zealand cluster. But being autonomous was the key for us. Allowing us to release when we wanted is the key. We're on weekly release cycles now, and we will move as quickly as we can to releasing when we want to, as we want to. So if a user story or feature is ready, we will release it. That's where we want to be. And on that release train, we didn't have that option. We were sucked into the entire, what everybody else wanted to do, mess. This is the final learning. I know I've been talking a lot. I'm going to ask you guys some questions in a moment. Learning number five is in three parts. 5A was, we were project thinkers. We funded everything through project thinking. We budget on projects. We say, this is what we're trying to achieve, what's in the scope. We do some bigger kind of front thinking about what that project looks like. We do some design usually, and we say, this is what we're building out. And to me, the analogy that I was using with this is that we did this with our migration. We said, we need to do all of this, and we can't go live, or we can't finish our migration until this is done. To me, it's like a reservoir of good ideas. A project is like a reservoir of good ideas. You start the project, you turn the tap on, and it's flowing gradually but slowly, and those new ideas are getting implemented, and you think you're running at a sustainable pace. And then gradually, because everyone's filled that reservoir with as many ideas as they can think of, especially the longer the project runs, the more ideas will get crammed into that reservoir, because they know it's the last chance they're going to get for 2 years to get those ideas into your project. Then they gradually, you realize as you progress that the reservoir is not emptying fast enough, and you're never going to meet your schedule. So you turn the tap on a bit higher, and you're trying to increase the pressure that you've got within that project, until eventually you're holding one of these things, and as a group of people, you're throwing as many people as you can, trying to hold that hose. It becomes very pressure driven. And we were experiencing this as we came through to the end of our migration. We had a lot to do still, and we wanted it done within our project budget. We wanted it done within, we had other things to do, and our business were really pressuring us to move on with it. So what we did was we negotiated. We talked to the business. We asked them, we challenged them on whether we really needed to complete all of these things that they wanted by that deadline. Did we really need to do all of this? Were there things that we could leave behind in our old content management system that we could do later? We could do properly later, instead of being in this kind of migration phase that we were in. Let's actually get to the end of the migration as quickly as we can, and then start to change things up. I've used Reagan and Gorbachev as an example because Reagan came into his first term. He really wasn't expecting anything from the Soviet Union. They were old school thinkers, very much in their old school kind of thinking. They were clashing quite severely during his first term. And then Gorbachev came into power and changed things up completely. And suddenly there was a dialogue. And Reagan, to his credit, a conservative president, wasn't expecting it, but he adapted to that change and he made it happen. That people now describe Reagan as being the arch pragmatist. And so, hat tip to him, he took that and he took that opportunity and he ran with it. He negotiated. And they went through several years of negotiation, but they got it done. So the final learning from this in learning five is that we've now shifted to product thinking, and product thinking for me is like a stream of ideas. It's a constant steady flow of things coming your way. There's not a build-up or a jam or a sudden increase in pressure. It's just a flow of ideas, and the way that you sustain that flow or keep it sustainable is that you have people prioritizing what is the most important thing for the teams to do. It works for both sides, because as a team do you get a constant flow of work that's sustainable and you can manage, but product management teams are able to prioritize things. you know, if the stream changes direction, which they often do, if someone puts something in their way, change direction, go with it, adapt and learn. And this is we've pivoted, as they call it in the lean startup, a number of times where the product management team have gone, yeah, that was a good idea last month, but it's no longer a good idea, and this is actually a higher priority. So with a product thinking or product approach, you can adapt and learn as you go, and you can really start to innovate around your products, your key products. You're not stuck in that, we've just got to get to the end of this project. We've just got to get to the end of this. You just pivot when you need to pivot. Lots of talking. How am I doing for time? This is our newsroom right now. This is Caleb. He lays out pages for the Dom Post and other mastheads. He's a designer. He designs layouts. He's always going to have a job with Fairfax. We're never going to ever, as long as we print newspapers, this guy is key to what we do. But as I said to you, the newsroom is changing, and we're going to this kind of leaner approach where journalists will have much more ownership over their content. They will take it from start to from creation through to publication and become what we call publish ready. And to do that, we have to change the software that they use. This is the reason I've got this picture up is this is our print layout software. This is the easy screen to understand in our print layout software. It is a specialist subject in its own right. What we're intending to do is write a system that overlays this and makes it much easier to publish print for all of our journalists. It will be basically a modern content management system, publication system, overlaying a very complex digital or print system, sorry. Yeah, we're trying to break these as much as we can. It seems a bit cliched, I know, but we are removing the structures across our business as much as we can. We realize that the whole of Fairfax has to talk to each other if we're going to be successful in this piece of work. So in terms of breaking down silos, that's the editorial team breaking the silos down. Those 700 journalists will now be able to distribute syndicate their content across our network wherever that content is wanted. They are not bound to one masthead or one community newspaper or one platform or endpoint. They can publish where they want to publish, or they can publish where they wanted to publish. Also on these, our sales team, our commercial team are restructuring as well. They will become much more focused. I was having a conversation with them the other day. They're creating T-shaped people. So they can sell, before they had people who sold fashion or cars or other specialist subjects, they've now created this team of people who go out and sell regional, but I'm trying to think of the word, but any of those items, you know, cars or fashion or so on, they can sell any of those. We've got an HR team who's rebranded themselves. They no longer manage our hiring process for us. They are our hiring assistants. We work with them they basically do all the work for us. They run around hiring, you know, putting our job adverts in the right places and so on. But they are very much on our side and working with us to hire the people we want and so on. So those are just some of the aspects of the way that we're removing our silos. And then finally, alternative channels. We have to for our businesses to survive, we have to move away from just one channel. We have to be able to publish our content where our audience wants it. And so we are actively seeking new places, new channels to distribute our content. So, for example, some of the things are fairly obvious around here. We've got social and national, but we're also looking at our membership offerings. Sorry, I'm turning away from my mic, aren't I? And we've also got... we're looking at traditional social, but we're also looking at something called Neighbourly, which is hyper-local. They're community-focused groups of people, and we'll syndicate community-related content through to those. Kind of platforms where people can get local news, hyper-local news as they're calling it. So takeaways from here. Hold a vision for change. And do think product. This product's crucial to your success. Don't think projects. Be realistic around your timelines, and then collaborate across your business. Get everybody talking. You are one company, one team. Sorry, I've done a lot of time, and I've hit the times up red just now. So I'm gonna. Do we have time for Q&A? 2 minutes. Cool. I actually got a question for you. Is anybody undergoing a digital transformation at the moment themselves? What's your experiences? What sector are you in? Okay, and what's you're thinking about it, but you've what's your business? What kind of what?
Government.
Okay. And how are you changing? Do you think what will change first? Right. So more interaction through your web, basically, and mobile. Yeah. Great. You're not from IRD, are you? Yeah. I just heard there's obviously a lot of talk about IRD's transformation at the moment, and it was just a wild stab in the dark, but cool. Any questions for me? That's a good question. So how do you challenge a business that needs to know project costs up front? It's not been easy, to be honest with you. But we've got some great product managers, and they are willing to do that work. We've coached those guys into the way that we want to work. They often, they basically talk in terms of timeframes to our executive management team, who are they're asking for money, and they will talk in terms of objectives, what they want or outcomes that they want to achieve. But they're very clever about not talking about absolutes or what we're going to do to achieve that. So they're basically setting out a roadmap, but it's a very high-level roadmap. And we want this done by then, and we want this done by that. But they're very value-driven in their approach. And so we will probably get that done by then. But they, as one of them said to me the other day, I've MVP'd the MVP. They prioritize things like crazy, and they will try and get a minimum viable product as quickly as they can. And if that means they will just cut and cut and cut so they can meet their objectives. It's a very smart way of thinking, but that's basically it in a nutshell, is you have a very lean approach to achieving what you want to achieve, and you talk in high level objectives and outcomes to your business who are giving you money. Yeah. Yeah. So the question is there more pressure on us as we're now perceived as a 24/7 business? And it's true. Yeah, we do. We've got journalists or editors in the newsroom, 24 hours, publishing. You often see though some people they do take a break and like they do. You'll often see latest story updates happening at 5 a.m. That's when a new shift is coming in. The aim is that we can allow our journalists to publish from their mobile devices ultimately, and we're looking at ways of for them uploading video from the field, for example, and other things. I don't know how soon we'll get to that kind of fully publishable state from mobile, or whether it just be certain parts of our content, but we're trying to make it easy for them. But yeah, they are never off, unfortunately, some of them, but we do work in shifts, fortunately.
Thank you. That's all the time we've got right now. But if you could please thank Paul again just for his wonderful contribution.
Thank you.
And if you could join us down in the Visa Gallery, we've got morning tea and all now. Or if you want to forego a little bit of that, I'm sure we've got a couple of minutes for a couple of people to have a couple more conversations here. Thank you.